I'm an editor at the Journal of British Art Studies, and we publish new research about British art, architecture, and visual culture online. Accessing the journal requires no fee or registration, and it's one of a handful of peer-reviewed open access art history journals in the world. British Art Studies is relatively young. It was founded in 2015 by two research institutes, the Paul Mellon Center for Studies in British Art and the Yale Center for British Art. And today, I'll speak about some of the key questions that arise in producing the journal, and I think those are relevant to any online museums or heritage publishing that involves presenting scholarly information in some way. So as a peer-reviewed publication, one of our earliest considerations was about longevity. In academia, citation signifies continuity in the field, and it's a proxy for legitimacy and for impact. And that system is threatened by the ephemeral nature of things published on the internet, where every day, innumerable web pages cease existing or change address. So how do we convince readers and authors that the journal can be referenced indefinitely, as safely as you might a book? Well, the first half of our solution is to pay a fee to deposit everything that we publish with a digital archive called Portico, which maintains it in perpetuity, irrespective of what happens to British Art Studies or to its infrastructure. And then we also actually assign stable URLs called digital object identifiers, or DOIs, hierarchically to all of the content. So separate URLs exist for each issue and for each article, chapter, paragraph, and figure, which link to that content regardless of how the original web address might evolve. And then if you click on those DOI icons, you can copy and paste them. And as you can see, you can actually reference material with a greater degree of granularity than you might with page numbers in a printed journal. And then finally, at the bottom of each feature, we suggest a full citation using its article DOI as well, which just is meant to illustrate how easily you can drop this into a bibliography. Another fundamental question to address was that of openness and copyright. The journal is funded generously by the research institutions that publish it, and a key goal in its establishment was to enrich open culture in academia and to break down barriers to research. So while our authors retain copyright of their contributions, they publish it with us under this Creative Commons license, which allows for non-commercial reuse and remixing. But there's also the question of how we license visual material for the journal itself. Having no printing costs makes it easier to illustrate much more profusely, but copyright fees in print and digital formats are still a huge barrier for many publishers, and often those fees end up being defrayed to the author, or images are simply omitted. In Britain and the US, where our editorial team is based, there are exceptions to copyright for uses related to criticism and review, but in many ways, this remains an area of law governed by broad principles and very few legal precedents, and so often authors and publishers will pay fees just to be safe. But in the long term, this can obviously have a negative impact because norms matter a great deal in law and they really depend upon practice. And so with the advice of an intellectual property specialist, we invoke exceptions to copyright where it's appropriate. We're very careful to be transparent and to notify known copyright holders. And we hope that through this example, we can empower and culture others to do the same. And then the last guiding question I'll speak about today, and certainly the broadest, has been how do we make the most of the digital format? How do we make the journal more than an electronic copy of a print publication, as you see here? And what can we do online that we can't do in print? So one approach that we took was to devise a series of features. These exist alongside more traditional article formats, and we hope that they publish research in new ways. We have the conversation piece. This is a multivocal feature where one scholar will write a provocation, and then between 10 and 20 colleagues in the field write short responses. This came from the idea that academia has these traditional outputs. It has the 10,000 word article, it has the monograph, but they only really represent a slice of what scholarly activity is, which is conferences, workshops, study days. And so the inspiration here was how do you publish these kinds of conversations between experts? We also have Look First, which is a primarily visual feature, so past versions of this have taken the form of a slideshow or a film. And partly what this does is to foreground a method of research, which is the act of looking closely and attentively that's so central to art history. But it's also a place where ideas that perhaps aren't suitable for an extended essay can still make a scholarly contribution through images. Our next feature, One Object, brings together a variety of authors from different and sometimes disparate specialisms to reflect on a single object. So in this particular case, a guest editor chose a Victorian choir screen from Hereford Cathedral in England. It's now in the collection of the V&A Museum. And contributions were from V&A curators, conservators, from art historians, medievalists, digital humanities scholars, and together they created a prismatic context for understanding the screen. And then finally, we have the cover collaboration. Essentially, each issue has multiple cover designs, and every time that you access the journal, you're randomly assigned a different one from that series. This has given us a platform for showcasing artistic work, both by researchers and by professional artists. And what you see here are these amazing photographs by Martin Parr, who for many decades has documented British life and who chose this selection for us. So as we explore these new kinds of scholarly publishing, the features I've just mentioned create a certain enduring structure from issue to issue. But it's also crucial that the journal adapts to the needs of individual research projects. For a number of submissions, we've built bespoke tools, and these, of course, add to a growing range of options for future authors. Here we have a slider that allows for close comparison between two versions or views of the same image. That's particularly useful when you're speaking about conservation, restoration, and artist's working practices. For another issue, an author demonstrated the various ways a 19th century exhibition at the British Institution might have been hung. So our digital manager worked with video game designers to create a 3D visualization of the space with the artworks installed. And then in this case, the authors had worked with a data set from the Getty Provenance Index. So again, we collaboratively built these interactive visualizations that we hoped would help readers to follow the author's analysis. I think these examples illustrate how the journal has been innovative, but I also do want to say that not every article has a special digital tool. Many take the standard format of a long text with static illustrations, and what we always really ask ourselves is, what supporting visuals would make the author's argument clearer and more compelling? How can we be sure to enhance their work digitally rather than to potentially distract? So the questions I've just talked about around citation and preservation, copyright and open access, and experimenting with our digital format have been incredibly formative over the last 2 years. We know that to keep growing, one important goal is to better understand our readers and their experiences using British art studies. We have the data you see here from Google Analytics, but we really have yet to pursue any more closely tailored analysis or surveys. I'm actually here speaking today because we won a People's Choice Award, but there's still a lot to learn about user experience and really the simple fact of trying to bring deep, extended reader attention to an image-rich online environment. We also don't know, for example, if readers care whether or not the journal content is grouped into issues. We have no postage and no printing costs to consider. And it may actually be that our community prefers to see new research sooner in a flow and on an ad hoc basis, rather than bundled into these packages 3 times a year, just because that's the print convention. Another area of growth will be to manage our sort of ever deeper and more complex collaborations. This is a list of nearly everyone who's been an author or guest editor in just 6 issues, the volume of which I think in part reflects the attempt I mentioned earlier to publish conversation. But collaboration is about more than volume. It's also been transforming our working practices as editors. So increasingly, rather than submitting a finished full-length essay, authors will pitch us an idea simply because they aren't sure whether or not what they envision is possible. If the project goes ahead, we would then facilitate collaboration between them and digital developers and inevitably become involved in planning and shaping that project. So this really creates a much more iterative and a much more flexible editorial process, which has to adapt, but it still has to adhere to academic standards. So sometimes, for example, we might peer review the same project twice, once as an outline and once when it's complete, just to make sure that it meets the same levels of rigor that other submissions would encounter. And then finally, looking ahead, I think what we're learning is that digital publishing seems to lead to more digital publishing. New online journals, many of which are open access, are appearing, and that's wonderful. But also within our own institutions, investments made early in digital projects seem to reap future rewards. The content management system that we invested in for British art studies and the development of staff expertise can be repurposed to other projects, the lessons from which we hope will feed back into the journal. Thank you.